This is the Watchman giving a clarion call. Folks, there's some big lies being circulated by our enemies right now. They're hitting us from every direction with a disinfo assault, intended to shake the resolve of our stacking forces. Now, one particularly wretched lie the enemy seems to be pushing right now with everything they've got is being repeated by so many people that I decided to dedicate an entire video to it. That silver lie goes something like this. All the silver pumpers out there, that's us, have said that we're heading for an inflationary collapse. We're not. No, we're heading for a deflationary collapse, where silver and gold will continue downward on the escalator to hell, chewing up mounds of turf as they faceplant forever. So, if you're smart, you'll ditch your silver and run to the safety of sweet, savory U.S. dollars and treasuries, because nothing's going to survive this deflationary collapse. Okay, that's the lie, and I intend to rip it to shreds, but before I do, I want to tell you a little story. A story that I've never told y'all before from personal experience. It's important because it explains why the lie you just heard about a crushing deflationary collapse taking silver with it for years is impossible. Now, this happened back in the crash of 2008, and there are several key takeaways from this story, so listen carefully. Back in 2008, when I first learned more of the troubles that the world financial system was in, I started investing in gold, silver, and gold mining shares. One such mid-cap stock was an Australian mining company called Oxiana, which mined gold and base metals. Now, Oxiana, when I bought it, was nearly $4 a share. And at that point, they were a healthy company with good earnings and had almost $1 billion, Australian dollars, in the bank. Everything was looking up for them. Until the banking collapse really kicked off in the ensuing months and credit evaporated, and taking the entire commodity complex to the earth, Oxiana was literally annihilated because copper, lead, and zinc all did a cliff dive somewhere between 75 to 80% of their high values. And as that was happening, the Australian dollar, which they had in the bank, lost 30% of its value against U.S. dollars. And to make matters even worse, Oxiana couldn't refinance their debt because credit was gone. It was a perfect storm. Now, to give you an idea of the carnage that ensued, in just 6 short months, Oxiana's price per share was crushed from $4 all the way down to 32 cents a share. And guess what? I bought all the way down. In fact, at the very bottom, I told myself, go big or go home. And I bought 12,000 more shares of Oxiana at the rock bottom. Now, I knew it was a big risk, but I also knew the payoff could be huge. Well, guess what happened? The company was so destroyed in just 2 business quarters that it went from having $1 billion in the bank to having no cash whatsoever. They burned through $1 billion like it was nothing because the changes that came so quickly they did not have time to adapt. Okay, the base metals went so absurdly low they had to literally mothball 80% of their base metal mines. I kid you not. Copper, nickel, and lead went so low, they put all of their mines on something called care and maintenance, okay, which kept these mines in fine working condition. But nothing was being produced by them. And it wasn't just Oxiana, you see. Dozens of other mining companies around the globe had to also mothball hundreds of other base metal mines out there because they were literally losing cash with every pound of lead, copper, or zinc that they brought out of the ground. It was just cheaper to leave it in the ground. And to top it all off, Oxiana days later, after I bought all those shares, suspended their shares from trading completely. For several months. Oxiana was quite virtually bankrupt, and here I had just sunk all that cash into it. They finally, to my great relief, after many midnight meetings with creditors, were bought out piecemeal by China. Now, China bought off most of their assets and allowed Oxiana to keep several mines, including a big gold mine, on their balance sheets. By selling those assets to China, I, as well as other shareholders, were saved, and Oxiana was rolled into a mining company called Oz Minerals, which recovered, and I sold later at a profit. Now, that's the story. Now, you may be thinking, well, Watchman, that's an interesting story, but what the heck does that have to do with disproving the notion that silver will suffer for years in a long-term deflationary depression? That's an excellent question. And the answer was in that story. Did you catch it? Remember how I said that base metals worldwide had gone so low that hundreds of mines had to be mothballed, totally shut down? Well, that's what's on the verge of happening again right now. You see, base metals have taken such a hit already that their mines are already on the verge of collapse again. And if there truly is a depressionary global slowdown, those base metals will quickly go cliff diving even more as they did before, bringing vast quantities of base metal mining to a grinding halt. And therein lies the problem. That's the fly in the ointment for our banking foes right now. You see, most of silver's ever-dwindling supply, in fact, nearly 70% of it, comes as a byproduct of base metal mining. The exact same types of base metal mines that were mothballed in the last deflationary collapse. But wait, it gets even more drastic than that. For as SRS Rocco has already shown us recently, several major primary silver miners who are already high-grading to maximize their silver output have experienced shocking year-over-year declines in silver production. So ladies and gentlemen, we're already staring down the twin barrels right now of peak silver combined with a collapsing base metal mining industry. There's an ugly silver deficit right now. But if you coupled that with a plunge in base metal silver supply, the silver riggers would run out of stockpiles to meet our demand within as little as a few months. It would be game over. Their false deflationary narrative that both they and their allies have worked so hard to promote around the clock throughout 2015 would instantly break apart like the brittle lie that it is. Warriors, understand. They want you. They need you to believe that silver and gold are no different than copper, zinc, or molybdenum in the event of another crash, because they want you to stop buying silver, and they want you to sell whatever silver you have. They will fail. They are failing at this right now, and they know it. If they try to turn off world credit spigots long enough to enact this languishing deflationary cycle that they desperately want you to believe in, they don't have enough silver available when the blood starts flying to keep silver capped throughout that process. There will be a massive industrial user delivery default. Someone big is not going to get their silver, and they are not going to be happy. And it will ignite something we have never seen before. A worldwide silver buying panic, fueled not by investors, but by Fortune 500 companies. And this will send silver to heights never before seen by any living person, I promise you. And it will instantly kill the false deflationary meme that the banksters have worked for years to convince us of. Now, why would it instantly kill it? Because a spiking silver and gold price is totally incompatible with a deflationary meme. It's like holding a cross in front of a vampire. It will instantly flee. It will instantly end. Think about it. If you're a big bondholder and you just bought a ton of 30-year U.S. debt for 2%, and you see silver spike to triple digits, are you still going to feel great about your financial and investing decisions? No! You'd pitch that debt to the first sucker you could, and you'd demand a much higher interest rate. Global bond markets will instantly react to spiking silver, I promise you. Which will kill the deflation meme everywhere, because silver and gold lead the entire commodity complex. And that commodity complex will follow them to the heavens. It's going to happen, and it cannot be stopped. And remember this, a financial panic will send already high silver demand soaring even further, just as it did in 2008. During that panic, investment demand went from a mere 50 million ounces to over 150 million ounces within 1 year. It took demand 100 million ounces higher, and that will easily happen again. So brothers, next time someone feeds you the line about a deflationary collapse cratering silver for years, ask them this. If silver supply is 70% from base metal miners, and base metal mining will crater and be raped again by a similar deflationary spiral as it did in 2008. And that base metal price drop shuts down most of that complex. Then riddle me this, where is the silver going to come from? And believe me, JP Morgan knows it too, and this is exactly why they've been preparing. They've been hedging. They've been stacking. They've been preparing. They've been getting ready. And that's why we're getting ready too. Okay? They know it. Oh, and there's one more takeaway from that story that I just told you. Remember how I said that Oz Minerals share price recovered? Well, I sold my shares for a reasonable profit, but I sold them far too soon. For if I had held on to them a little longer, I could have sold those shares for a 400% gain in just 2 years. My point is, investing stories are like fishing stories. Usually the big one just gets away from you, doesn't it? And my friends, silver is the big one. When this fish bites and the spike comes, it will surprise everyone, but not you. Many others who own silver will pitch it too soon, foregoing life-changing gains, but not you. Many others will live with lifelong regret that they trolled random silver channels instead of selling their possessions to acquire all the silver they possibly could. But not you. Silver is the big one. And don't you dare let some silly deflationary meme scare you into letting it get away. This is the Watchman signing off. Stay vigilant and bring the fight to them.